It's 10 o'clock. This is Sky News at 10. Our top story, new tricks, new records and more medals. Gymnast Max Whitlock retains his Olympic title in Tokyo. After BMX rider Charlotte Worthington became the first woman to successfully complete a 360-degree backflip in a competition.
We've been searching for, like, this gold medal trick, essentially, that was going to get us there. And there's a couple of things we thought it might have been, and then once I started trying this trick, it just kind of came.
Plus, the Belarusian athlete who says she's being forcibly repatriated, now being protected by Japanese police, also tonight.
I've never seen this before. We've had little fires before, but I've never seen this devastation.
Rescued from the Med, tourists and locals are ferried from beaches in Turkey and Greece as wildfires threaten holiday resorts. Afghan security services struggled to contain the resurgent Taliban, who now have three major cities in their sights. The backlash against UK travel restrictions. Now the Chancellor joins calls to relax the rules. And we'll take a full look at tomorrow's front pages in our press preview from 10:30. Good evening. In the pool, on the track and on the pommel horse, Team GB enjoyed more Olympic success today, breaking records and adding to the growing haul of medals. Day 9 got off to a flying start, literally, when Charlotte Worthington landed a 360-degree backflip in the women's BMX Park freestyle final. A silver for the swimming relay team made Duncan Scott the most decorated British athlete at a single Games, while gymnast Matt Whitlock retained his Olympic title. Our sports correspondent Tom Parmenter reports from Tokyo.
There are things that Charlotte Worthington does on her BMX that just look impossible. A few years back, she was working as a chef in a Mexican restaurant in Manchester, dreaming of a day like this. And she dared to try new moves. It was a 360 backflip that landed a gold.
We've been searching for, like, this gold medal trick, essentially, that was going to get us there. And there was a couple of things we thought it might have been. And then once I started trying this trick, it just kind of came. And we were like, that's it, that's the one.
Max Whitlock was already Team GB's greatest ever gymnast, but he too found another level, retaining his Olympic title on the pommel horse with an incredibly hard routine that he made look easy. Through lockdowns, he's used his garden as his gym, but nothing could knock him off course in defending his title from Rio. He's 28, but determined to go to Paris for the next Olympics.
I can't believe that's just happened. Thank you, everybody. It's been an incredible journey. Team GB, everybody, so grateful to have that moment with Scott on the floor with me. Cannot believe I'm coming home with a gold medal. Thank you so much for everybody's support. It means the world.
But the biggest British success has been in the pool, where the 4x100 men's team landed silver. A spectacular week that all started with Adam Peaty's breaststroke victory.
For us, it's kind of the ball started rolling, and I think, you know what, I'm going to latch onto that. And Duncan did, and Tom Dean did. And once that momentum was carrying forward, you know, he started it off, and I think that's where it came from. And that's where it's been coming from since Rio.
We're not just going to sit back and go, oh, that's amazing. Of course we are, for a brief moment, but we're always looking, okay, how can we peak again? How can we get better from this? And that's the shift that we've made. And that's the shift that every team should make. We shouldn't have to sit on the fruits of our labour and just be happy.
Duncan Scott has four of those precious medals, the most of any Team GB athlete in one Olympics.
The thing that is really positive, that was 22 of the team. It's their first ever Olympics. So there is a lot of young faces on the team and ready to for the next 3 years to move things on, which I think is great.
It is now the point at which Olympic Games start to be judged, and that comes down to moments and medals. In Rio 5 years ago, they took home an incredible 67 medals. We are now over halfway through these Tokyo Games, and that record is in their sights. While British rowing has slipped back and athletics is still waiting for a big moment, the pendulum has swung towards new sports that are vying for attention and the ones that are really delivering the goods. Tom Parmenter, Sky News, Tokyo.
Team GB has so far failed to deliver on the athletics track, but successes elsewhere mean they're now in sixth place with 10 goals. China tops the leaderboard with 24, and the United States are in second place.
The stuff we do is life-threatening if it goes wrong. So that brings an element of excitement.
And coming up later in the programme, the dangerous urban sport now delivering medals in Tokyo. We'll report from Charlotte Worthington and Declan Brooks' BMX track in Corby. Away from the medal action, a Belarusian Olympic athlete is tonight under protective police custody in Tokyo after claiming that she was being threatened with forcible repatriation. Kristina Timandovskaya was due to compete in the women's 200 metres tomorrow. She says she's scared to go home and is seeking political asylum in Europe after criticising national coaches at the Games. Ivor Bennett reports.
At Tokyo's Haneda Airport, a Belarusian sprinter is being protected by police against a threat she claims that's from her home nation. Kristina Timanovskaya says she was being forcibly repatriated for publicly criticising her coaches and so posted a video online calling for help.
I'm asking the International Olympic Committee for help. I'm being put under pressure to leave the country. I'm asking the IOC to get involved in this.
The IOC says it's spoken with the 24-year-old, who's being guarded by police, and received assurances from airport staff that she is safe. A Japanese refugee lawyer was seen speaking to officers, offering the athlete counsel. After running in the 100-metre heats on Friday, she was due to compete in the 200 metres on Monday. But the athlete was withdrawn from the Games completely after complaining online about how she had been entered into another event, the 400-metre relay, at short notice. What followed, campaigners say, was yet another example of the Belarusian surveillance state and how its citizens aren't even safe on the other side of the world.
This whole situation began when pro-government and propaganda channels started a negative campaign against her. It was quite serious and a clear signal that her life would be in danger in Belarus.
Dissent is rapidly stamped out in the Eastern European country, where authoritarian leader Alexander Lukashenko has held power for nearly 30 years. Mass protests against a disputed election last summer were followed by a brutal crackdown that saw athletes who took part defunded, demoted and detained. The Belarusian Olympic Committee says Timanovskaya was taken off the team because of her emotional and psychological condition. She says it's because she spoke out and is now refusing to return home. Ivor Bennett, Sky News.
And Team GB's Olympic success features in tomorrow's newspapers. Here's the Metro showing off pictures of gold medalists Charlotte Worthington and Max Whitlock. And that story is making Monday's front pages. We'll be taking a first look in our press preview tonight at 10:30 with columnist and broadcaster Steve Richards and political commentator and broadcaster Salma Shah. To Europe now, where the most severe heat wave in decades has fueled wildfires and caused holiday resorts and entire villages to be evacuated. Fanned by soaring temperatures, strong winds and climate change, this year's fire season has been significantly more destructive than in previous years, with multiple blazes across the Mediterranean. They've been burning across Turkey since Wednesday. Eight people have been killed and hundreds more injured. Large fires are also tearing through western Greece, and firefighters in Sicily are battling dozens of blazes after temperatures in the region topped 45 degrees. Shingi Mararike reports.
These are some of Europe's most popular holiday destinations, but not like we're used to seeing them. Vast swathes of tourist towns in the Mediterranean are ablaze. In Turkey, more than 100 wildfires have erupted since Wednesday. Water cannon, usually reserved for controlling riots, instead being used by emergency services to tackle a blaze threatening to engulf the city of Bodrum. Authorities in the country say most of the fires are under control, but a handful rage on. For those being evacuated, the relaxation of a holiday was replaced by panic as flames descended on coastal resorts.
Our nation should be at ease. We will not allow any of our citizens to suffer. We will cover all the damages. Forest fires in our country doubled after leaders of the terrorist organisation PKK gave the order to burn our forests last year. We do not rule out that these fires were started by a similar instruction.
Many having to flee their homes say it will be hard to recover from the damage caused by the flames.
Something is different because I've never seen this before. We've had little fires before, but I've never seen this devastation. And it's not just here, it's everywhere.
Turkey's president suspects some of the fires may have been started deliberately, but it's hard to ignore the spectre of rising temperatures across southern Europe. There are also heat waves in other areas, including here. This beach resort close to the town of Catania was turned to charred remains while firemen battled dozens of wildfires in the area. Emergency services have asked for reinforcements from Rome.
Tonight, similar scenes BMX in Greece too,
where flames fanned by strong winds race down slopes and threaten seaside villages. Tourists can leave, but the people who live here have to deal with this. Homes, livelihoods destroyed. As temperatures rise and the effects of climate change continue to be felt, scenes like this will only become more common. Shingi Marike, Sky News.
Taliban rocket struck an airport in Afghanistan overnight as clashes continue to intensify since the withdrawal of Western forces. The Taliban have made rapid gains in rural areas and tens of thousands of people have been displaced. There are now fears the country is on the brink of a humanitarian crisis, as Hannah Thomas-Peter reports.
A refugee camp in northern Afghanistan, filling up with frightened people. They have fled to comparative safety as the Taliban continues to gain ground in other parts of the country, claiming territory and control as international forces complete their withdrawal. The violence is getting worse, and the UN is warning of an imminent humanitarian crisis.
There was war. Bombs were being dropped. My father was killed there, and a lot of my relatives were killed as well, and we had to flee.
Good evening,
I was responsible for my children, and I didn't want them to be killed, so I came here with my elderly mother.
Up until this point, the Taliban have been advancing easily through rural areas. But now, they have their sights set on three major cities, pushing to re-establish an Islamic emirate. Lashkar Gah is particularly vulnerable right now. It is the capital of Helmand province and where many US and British soldiers lost their lives. Kandahar is being targeted too. Tens of thousands of people have already been displaced. In Herat, Afghan special forces have been deployed and it's believed civilians have been mobilized to take on the militants.
In three provinces, the security situation is critical, especially in Lashkar Gah. The enemy has some movements. Security and defensive forces are planning to intercept the enemy's movements first, then build defensive lines and later launch offensive operations.
With Lucrezia Millerini. With no peace deal in sight, Afghan citizens continue to suffer. This hospital bombed by Afghan forces who believed Taliban fighters were being treated there.
Our hospital was bombarded, but there were no Taliban in the hospital. There were only six staff members from a total of 40 staff members working with us, and they were pharmacists and nurses, and two of our nurses were wounded. A patient's caretaker was martyred, and another patient's caretaker was wounded.
And a few days ago, the UN office and its staff police were also caught up in the fighting. By September, almost all foreign troops will have left Afghanistan. If its government cannot find a way to fill that gap and quickly, the future for this troubled country and its 38 million citizens is far from certain. Hannah Thomas-Peter, Sky News.
Police say they're keeping an...
Daily coronavirus infections in the UK fell again today. A further 26,144 new cases of coronavirus were reported in the latest 24-hour period. And 71 more people have died after contracting COVID. That takes the total number of deaths within 28 days of a positive test to 129,654. 35,773 first doses of a COVID vaccine were given, and 164,295 people received their second dose. That means 38.13 million people are now fully vaccinated against COVID-19. Well, from tomorrow, fully vaccinated passengers from the EU and US will be welcomed back into Britain without the need to quarantine. But pressure is building on the Prime Minister to redraw foreign travel restrictions before the summer is out, including from his own Chancellor. Emma Birchley reports.
Katie Forbes has only just got home from her hen weekend, but uncertainty over whether Greece will be
now
added
the
to the
ITV News
Plus list means she doesn't know whether any of these friends will even make it to Santorini to see her marry Dan after two postponements already.
It's caused us both a lot of anxiety and stress and sleepless nights and trying to understand the English, the Welsh and the Greek restrictions and how they impact the guests. Has been really, really stressful.
The latest update to the travel list is expected on Thursday, with speculation that both Greece and Spain could be added to Amber Plus as the case rate rises. It means self-isolating back in the UK, double jabbed or not.
The only certain thing for travellers is that nothing is certain and everything can be thrown up in the air with a single announcement. It was only on Wednesday that the government said fully vaccinated passengers from the US and Europe would be able to arrive without the need to quarantine from Amber List countries, prompting a rush of bookings for flights arriving after 4 a.m. on Monday.
Luke Glennon and his family live in Switzerland. They haven't been to Britain since their younger son's christening 2 years ago. But the grandparents will have to wait a bit longer to see how much the boys have grown.
I'm really excited. I can't wait to give my mum and dad a big hug and see everybody at home. But I'm going to come on my own, first of all, because I'm not really sure what all the procedures will be like, how it's going to feel. So I'll do that first before the rest of the family will follow then in a few weeks' time.
The constant confusion has prompted a number of UK airline bosses to write to the Transport Secretary, urging the government to put more countries on the green list and reduce the amount of testing. Despite tentative steps forward, time is fast running out to put the UK's aviation, travel and tourism industries back on track for a sustainable recovery to protect the millions of jobs they support, it says. We cannot afford to stand still over this vital summer period and urge you to act. And with so much left unclear for those travelling to the likes of Mallorca, pressure for change is coming from all angles. The Chancellor is said to have written to the Prime Minister calling for a relaxation of the rules.
Even the experts are having trouble following these new rules. So in terms of the confusion, the chaos, and of course the unprofitability they're causing to the travel sector.
Katie and Dan are flying out to Santorini on Friday, 3 weeks before getting married at the same venue they'd booked for last year. They've decided to go ahead whatever happens. And even if there's good news this week, there's one more announcement due before they know for sure if their guests will be able to join them to share the view. Emma Birchley, Sky News.
Three people, including a teenager, have been arrested on suspicion of murder after a five-year-old boy was pulled from a river
in
Bridgend. Good
evening and welcome to UTV.
South Wales police were called at 5:45 a.m. on Saturday after reports of a missing child. The boy's body was found soon after in the Ogmore River. A 39-year-old man, a 30-year-old woman and a 13-year-old boy are being questioned over his death. Nearly 400 migrants were rescued in the Mediterranean overnight after an overcrowded wooden boat got into difficulty off the coast of Tunisia. Many of those rescued were injured, some with severe chemical burns caused by exposure to gasoline. The craft had begun to take in water and several people could be seen jumping overboard and swimming to safety. The real estate investors Blackstone have announced plans for a major new centre for film, television and digital production in Hertfordshire. The development, which is subject to planning permission, is expected to create more than 4,500 permanent jobs and contribute more than £300 million to the local economy in Broxbourne each year. The UK today joined the US and Israel in saying it highly likely Iran is responsible for a deadly attack on an oil tanker off the coast of Oman earlier this week. Two crew members, one British national and the other Romanian, were killed. Let's speak to our foreign affairs editor now, Deborah Haynes. And Deborah, the Foreign Secretary describing the attack as unacceptable.
Yes, they didn't say it was highly likely. They said it was Iran that carried out the attack. They said it was highly likely that drones were used, one or more drones, on this tanker. And to give you a sense of just how seriously the UK government is taking this, I understand that the COBRA Emergency Committee meeting was held over the weekend at officials' level, not at ministerial level, which is what happens in the gravest of crises, but it's to look at the focus on how to respond to this attack. And that's, we can see a strong response from the UK government, from the Foreign Secretary's words, which came out this afternoon. And I can read a few lines from them. He said, "We believe this attack was deliberate, targeted, and a clear violation of international law by Iran. The UK is working with our international partners on a concerted response to this unacceptable attack." And his words were then followed by his US counterpart, who said that there would be an appropriate response forthcoming. We can expect in the immediate term the response to be diplomatic, but clearly the UK and its allies very concerned about this escalation in the Arabian Sea.
Deborah, thank you. Let's get the latest sport now from James.
This sports bulletin is brought to you by Vitality, committed to getting 100 million people 20% more active by 2025.
At the age of 6, I had meningitis, septicemia. And they said I'd never walk again. My Achilles in my left leg shrunk, so that meant that sort of my knees weren't in line with my hips. So they said that I'd constantly have problems with that. A year and a half later, I started going outside. I was back walking, running. And then I got signed for QPR, age 8. So yeah, it's a miracle really that I was being able to walk and run again.
How did you go from, you know, struggling to walk to being able to run around and be able to play with the kids, but the kids were really good at football?
Both my legs were in plaster for about 6 months. I was in a wheelchair. I can't remember exactly how I started walking again, but I used to have to wear like night splints. So my legs were constantly in splints to help me walk. Mentally, when I come out of hospital, I was like a different child. My mum said it wasn't the same child that went into hospital. I had brain damage from it. And I was on life support for 6 days. I've got obviously ADHD, I was diagnosed OCD, personality disorder. I've got a few things. So that, as well as sort of playing football, was a massive sort of risk. I was lonely. I felt like at a very lonely place with this injury now. Beforehand, I was constantly on a high. I always thought I will get through whatever I go through, and that's the way I do see it, because I do, whatever I go through, I do get through eventually. And it sort of proved that I do. But I'm driven to really do well, and I don't want to let myself down. And my last game I played was on the 20th of January, 2020. I've started to feel really unwell, and I felt like my throat was swelling. I remember going to bed and waking up, and I thought I was dying. I remember sitting there on the end of the bed and sort of saying, sorry.
It's okay.
I remember saying to the nurse, like, my mental health was bad and this has really, really topped it off. And she got sort of a woman to come around and speak to me. And the woman, I know she was trying to help. She was saying, you know, doesn't matter about football, like you can take another journey. And I remember sitting there thinking, another journey? I've worked so hard for this, and it's not about taking another journey. This is something I love and it's been taken away from me. So being on crutches and not being able to move around, not being able to feel my leg, I honestly thought it was the end of the world. I can now only feel the inside and the back and the front. I still can't feel the whole outside of my leg. And they said that probably won't repair. But I think the scary part now is I might not play competitively. I might not. But in my head, I feel like I know I will. Bees were brilliant with me. They kept me going.
Yes!
Yes! Committed to getting 100 million people 20% more active by 2025.
Sexual violence against disabled women in England and Wales has more than doubled in the past 6 years. But even when cases make it to court, conviction rates are low, leading to calls from campaigners for better training for police officers. Today, Sky News heard from one survivor who described her assault as invasive and dehumanising. Lisa Dowd reports.
Almost every time she goes out, Primrose deals with ignorant comments about her disability. But some incidents have been far more sinister. She asked us to hide her identity.
What's the worst thing that's happened to you?
I think it was the man who pinned my wheelchair. He came up and put his hand over my wheelchair controls and had another hand in his trousers, pleasuring himself, whilst asking if he could care for me. It was invasive and dehumanising, and it makes you feel like one inch tall.
The problem is escalating in England and Wales, according to official statistics.
The latest figures suggest that sexual violence against disabled women has more than doubled in the last 6 years, and one campaign group claims that not one of those cases has reached the courts.
Victims want better training for police officers to improve conviction rates.
What I've found is when speaking with survivors, they'll say things to me like, well, the police didn't believe that I could have been assaulted because they sort of thought, well, who would want to hurt a disabled person? Or they thought, well, disabled people aren't having sex. So there's very much this portrayal of disabled people as being asexual or desexualized.
Those involved in training police officers say the conduct does not follow guidelines.
What our training makes very clear is that you cannot have the diminishing or the demeaning of what the allegation is. If somebody comes to a police station or calls the police and makes an allegation of sexual assault, this is a serious matter to be believed at the point of reporting and then investigated fully.
There is a new victims code which enhances the rights of disabled people and extra government funding to support survivors from marginalised communities. But Primrose fears there'll be no real change until those with disabilities are taken seriously. Lisa Dowd, Sky News.
Well, in response to our report, a CPS spokesperson said, "We are working closely with victim services to improve how we communicate with victims to help them understand and support them through the process." Our prosecutors also undergo trauma training to ensure that they are able to evaluate evidence whilst taking into consideration how trauma can impact on memory, behaviour and demeanour. 5 years ago, Team GB Charlotte Worthington was rolling burritos as a chef in a Mexican restaurant. Today, she pulled off one of the most remarkable moments in BMX history. Her stunt was the culmination of a remarkable medal run, 2 golds, a silver and a bronze. Fraser Maud reports from Corby on the rise of a daredevil urban sport.
BMX used to be seen as a sport for mavericks and misfits. But the Tokyo Olympics has changed all that. Team GB's haul of 2 gold medals, a silver and a bronze, a remarkable return for one of the lesser funded sports. Charlotte Worthington won gold in the BMX freestyle thanks to her landing an incredible backflip 360, a trick never before seen in a major competition. She was first discovered by British Cycling after appearing in Sky's Revolution, where BMXers faced off against skateboarders over obstacle courses and in high jump competitions. Back home in Manchester today, her family are, in adrenaline sports terminology, stoked.
I think she just relaxed and took each trick as it came and got a fantastic result, yeah. So it was just amazing. But we kind of knew she'd got it in her, didn't we, John?
Yeah. Mick's the roller coaster of emotions.
Roller coaster of emotions,
throughout
yeah.
about 10 minutes.
Despite being knocked unconscious in the World Championships in June, Declan Brooks bounced back to grab a brilliant bronze.
It's just one of those sports that you just can't take your eye off. The stuff we do is life-threatening if it goes wrong. So that brings an element of excitement to anyone, and everyone loves a crash as long as they're okay. But that's what makes it exciting, and that's what keeps bringing us back.
Charlotte and Declan both perfected their skills at Adrenaline Alley in Corby.
For Charlotte to sort of obviously fall out in the first round, to pick herself up and just do what she did, getting a 97.5, which is the biggest in BMX history, male and female, to do that is phenomenal.
I ride with Dec Charlotte like every time I ride almost. We train together, and to see the journey they've come on since I first met them is like insane. Like them going out there, everyone had expectations and they've just put them through the roof.
It's when you see the BMX freestyle close up that you realise just how dangerous it can be. In other sports, a mistake might cost you a tenth of a second or a few points. In BMX, it could mean a serious injury. BMX success in the park and on the track has brought the F word to the fore once again. Funding.
We should have the correct amount of funding, as should every sport, and it should be averaged out over every sport, so we all get the correct funding, and then everyone can achieve their goals that they want to achieve at the Olympics.
The BMX riders will certainly be hoping for a bigger slice of the Team GB money pie to help turn more mavericks into medalists. Fraser Maud, Sky News, Corby.
Coming up, we'll take a first look at tomorrow's newspapers in the press preview, including this story on the front of the Daily Mail, which has the headline, Pay for Your Own Heart Op. That says the paper says growing numbers of patients are paying for life-saving surgery because of NHS waiting lists. Tonight, we're joined by Steve Richards and Salma Shah. Do stay with us.